very much for coming tonight. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Megan Dupes, and yes, Dupes is my real last name. It is spelled D-U-P-E-S, and by dictionary standards, that means to fool or be fooled. That's pretty much what I plan on doing to you tonight. It's amazing to me, though, how many people get such a simple name wrong. I frequently get Dupes, Dupes, Dupree. Not sure where that one comes from since there's no R in it, but Dupree and Dupe. I kind of like the Dupe one, but it's a lot fancier than Dupes, but unfortunately I can't go with it because it's not my last name. But the other nice thing I find interesting about people that can't pronounce my last name is it really helps me to weed out the idiots. What I mean by that is when the phone rings and I hear, yeah, I'd like to speak to Megan Dupes, I immediately know two things. One, I don't know this person, and two, they're trying to sell me something. So my simple response to that is, I'm so sorry, there's nobody by that name that lives here, you have the wrong number, click, I'm done. It's easy, simple, I never have to speak to a solicitor again. Use that one, it works every time. Now, I want to point out one thing, in case those of you haven't noticed yet. It kind of stands out, but I'll just bring it out to your attention. And that is that, no, I don't have any tattoos. You know, we all know how gravity works, and I'm a huge Winnie the Pooh fan. I really am, for sentimental reasons. I'm always going to love him. But I can't justify what I want on my body at 80. Knowing where gravity goes with it. I mean, think about it. A tramp stamp of Winnie the Pooh right here. When I'm 80 years old, I'm going to be wearing Depends. The last thing I need is to have poo trickle down my back. Adding insult to injury. It's just not going to happen. I can't do it. By profession, I'm a self-professed domestic goddess. Now, I know I haven't coined that phrase. I didn't make that one up, but another comedian made that up, but I think it fits me fairly well, because really it's just slang for sits on your ass eating bonbons on watching TV all day, because that's pretty much all I do. I hate to clean, so I don't. In fact, when you walk up to my front door, I have a sign hanging by the door that says, enter laughing. I keep my house the way I do so that you will feel better about your own. You are so welcome. Now, I do the bare minimum, you know, enough to keep DSS from taking my kids away from me for living in squalor, but that's it. I cross the line at that point. I don't do any more. And the other thing I like about calling myself a domestic goddess is that when you fill out forms and paperwork and it gets to that occupation line, you know, housewife, homemaker, it's a little boring. So I put domestic goddess down. Now, it really is great because it helps me notice if people are really paying attention to what I've written. One day I was at the doctor's office and the nurse was typing in all the information, you know, yada, 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 yada. And all of a sudden she stops and she spins around and she turns to me and she goes, oh my God, domestic goddess? Does that mean you sell sex toys? Yes. No, not unless Fisher-Price came out with a new line that I'm not familiar with. Don't do anything like that. Now, I don't cook and clean. I hate to cook, actually, and I really detest baking. And I was very lucky to marry a man that is a really, really good baker. In fact, I married him for his cheesecake. My idea of baking is taking those tubes of cookie dough, you know, those pre-made cookie dough tubes, unwrapping the plastic just enough so that you have a little bit of the plastic left so you can hold it in your hand, and you pass it around to each other with a spoon. That's how I cook. My husband, not so much. He's the real baker in my family. Now, the day I realized that I should never bake again was the day I received a letter in the mail from Betty Crocker herself. It was a cease and desist letter. It said, if you ever use our product again, or tell people that you use our product, we will have you arrested to the fullest extent of the law. I have not touched my oven since. Awesome. Love it. So, moving on, I hate technology. I'm so technologically inept, it isn't even funny. I barely know how to turn the damn things on. If I need help, I'm always constantly calling my kids. Oh, Mom, come on, you can't figure that out. Well, obviously, if I could, I wouldn't be calling you. But above and beyond technology and my ineptness to it, I do threaten to throw my computer out the window on a daily basis. I'm lucky I can turn it on. I'm barely lucky I can do anything to it. But the technology piece that I hate the most is cell phones. I have one of those dumb phones, you know, those kind that you pay as you go. I don't even know my cell phone number because I don't turn it on. And people look at me like I have two heads, like, what do you mean you don't know your cell phone number? I only carry it around to call out. What is so pressing that my answering machine at home can't handle? I mean, seriously, I don't care. And what I hate the most about cell phones is that people seem to not realize that if they're on the cell phone, if they do not include an invisible phone booth that blocks out their conversation from the rest of the world. I was in the freezer section one day and I had my back to the aisle and I was digging through the freezers, you know, or the bags of grocery or vegetables and trying to decide what my kids will eat. And I hear, "Hi, how are you?" I'm great. How are you? Well, I just got the test results today. Oh, and what were they? I'm not pregnant. Oh, I'm so sorry to hear that. And as I have my 15 bags of broccoli and I dump them into the cart and I'm about to console my friend, and I look up and I realize, holy shit, I have no idea who this person is. She has a cell phone attached to her ear and she's not even talking to me. And she has this crazy look on her face. She puts the phone down and she says to me, "How dare you invade on my phone conversation?" And I look at her and I look around the aisle and I said, "You do realize that you just announced to all 15 people in the freezer section that you're not pregnant and you have the nerve to be pissed at me? Are you crazy?" She just walked away in a huff. I actually heard somebody give their complete credit card number over the phone, cell phone, in a store. I'm like, you deserve to have your identity stolen. You do. And I hope it is. Because you just gave license to anybody who wanted to write it down. Now, the one thing I do like about cell phones is it gives you license to drive around in your car and talk to yourself without people thinking you're crazy. Because I do talk to myself a lot, but obviously I just admitted that it's not on the cell phone, but nobody knows that because they think I'm on the phone. So my kids have one of those Bluetooth headset things, right? And so I tried a little experiment. It's, you know, it's supposed to be for those gaming so they can talk to their friends or whatever. I don't know. I don't even play video games. That's how technologically inept I am. But I decided I was going to do this little experiment and see what happened. So I took it, and it just slides over your ear, you know, those Bluetooth things. And I put it on, and I walked around this giant big box store talking to myself. Not one person looked at me like I was crazy because they really thought I was on the phone. But in reality, I was making fun of every last one of those people, but they didn't even notice because they just thought, "Oh, she's on the phone. She's not talking to me." It was so much fun. I'm telling you. I highly recommend it. It is such a treat to do that. So, my husband and I have this list of five. Does anybody here know what the list of five is? Have you heard of the list of five?
No.
It's actually not an original idea to myself. But we've had this for years. The list of five is that we allow each other to have a list of five famous people that we would give each other permission to have an affair with should the occasion actually arise. Of course, we know it's not actually going to happen because it's they're famous people, but it kind of spices things up and, you know, it's a little fun. Is she on your list? Is he on your list? My list periodically changes, but my number one person has always been and always will be Stephen Page, who is the former front singer to Bare Naked Ladies. He's now a solo artist, but Bare Naked Ladies is a band of men. They're not naked women. I did have to explain to my mother-in-law that no, I'm not infatuated with a band of naked women. But he, at the time, when he was still with Bare Naked Ladies, they came out with a children's CD. Now, in our household, Stephen Page is not just known as mom's number one man. He's also known as your future father or daddy number two. I even have a shrine of pictures of him on my kitchen cabinet door. I have a very patient husband. He's really kind. Funny thing is, one day my mother-in-law was at the house, and she goes, I don't remember Alan being there. Where did you take that picture? And it wasn't even him, but she thought it was her own son. I'm like, well, hell, if it really happened, she knows. This is awesome. So they came out with it several years ago. They came out with while Stephen was still with the band, they came out with a children's CD. And to promote it, they were coming to Framingham to a big box bookstore, and they were going to give a free half an hour concert with a meet and greet afterwards where you can get things autographed. And I thought, oh my God, I have been going to Bare Naked Lady concerts for years, and I've never gotten this close to my number one man. We are going. And at the time, the kids were young enough that they still thought Bare Naked Ladies was pretty cool, and I think that they liked the most about it was that they were going to get to miss a day of school. Now, I billed it as a highly informational and educational musical enrichment field trip. That's what I told the school. In reality, they were going to go meet their new father. So we get to the bookstore, and the venue is really small. I mean, really, just about the size of this room, and it was amazing. I've never been this close to my number one man, and I mean, there was even some eye contact between the two of us. I was in heaven. I don't know, I think my kids were still there. I really wasn't. I didn't care about them at that point, but Stephen and I, it was really happening. Sparks were flying. And at the end of the show, you got into this huge line to get your autographs. Well, the boys had made some cute little things to give to the band. And so we decided to get to the end of the line so that we could have some extra time with their autograph session, and I could have some extra time with my man. And so we get there, and I'm literally standing this close to Stephen Page, and I'm thinking, holy shit. I could actually, like, jump the table and actually have permission from my husband to do my number one man. Unfortunately, the kids were with me. And we were in public, so it didn't happen. But it could have. It could have. But, of course, all good things have to come to an end. And so, knowing that we live in Plymouth and Framingham was a far distance, I said, all right, guys, this is it. You know, it's time to go home. But I want you to go to the bathroom before we get in the car because it's a long trip and, you know, traffic, blah, blah, blah. Okay, Mom. And I'm like, all right, you go in the boys' room, I'll go into the girls' room, and when you come out, you can sit right here in this chair. Right here. When I come out, this is where I want you. Okay, okay. So I come out of the woman's room, and they did what they were told. They were both sitting in the chair, and my one son had this look on his face like, if he didn't get to share what information he had at this very moment, he was going to explode. Now, knowing that they had just come out of the men's room without an adult, I'm thinking, what the hell just happened in the men's room? So I say, he's like, are you okay? What's going on? He goes, Mom, guess what just happened? And I'm thinking, holy shit, what just happened in the men's room? Mom, I just peed with Bare Naked Ladies. Oh my God! My son just had the second most intimate experience you could have with another human being, and this is something I will never get to experience. But of course, I have to play it cool because I'm in the middle of a bookstore, and I don't know if the band's still lurking around the corner, and my kids are looking at me, and I'm like, wow, honey, that's really awesome. Wow, do you realize you just got to do something with the Bare Naked Ladies that mommy's never going to get to do? Yep. So as benignly as could, I started asking questions, like, who all was in there with you?
All five of them.
Wow. Did they talk to you?
Yep.
Nice. What'd they say? Hi. Did you like the show? Did you answer back?
Yep.
What'd you say?
I said hi back and then I liked the show.
Awesome. Did they wash their hands?
Yep.
Wow. Again, as calmly as I could, I said, this is amazing. You do understand that, again, you got to do something with the Bare Naked Ladies that I will never get to do.
Yep.
But you're not going to tell anyone, are you, Mom?
Of course not.
Of course I'm not ever going to mention this. All right, guys, go ahead and get in the car. As they scamper off, I'm standing there in the middle of the bookstore, ready to explode, because I realize that my son will go to the grave with the only two questions that I wanted to scream out. How big was his penis and was he circumcised? But I digress. So, as you can tell by my appearance, I'm a little unconventional. I actually like it when people stare at my hair. I play with it a lot because, you know, it is temporary, and I really truly don't have any tattoos because I'm afraid of needles and gravity and all that jazz. But since September, I've had it baby pink, I've had it purple, and over Christmas holidays, I had it as blue. And it was pretty cool. I liked it. You know, I'm having fun with it. But the best is when you walk into some place, and like actually most of you when I walked in, the expressions that I get are priceless. In fact, I wish I had a camera hidden somewhere so that I could take pictures of the people that look at me. She's how old? So at Christmas time, again, like I said, I had my hair blue, and I was shopping, and I had the cutest little old lady come up to me, and she goes, "Honey, it's okay. You're awfully young to have to cover those graves. But just remember, stay away from that Clairol number 45. Of course, she's like 96, and I couldn't be rude to her, so I simply said, "Oh, thank you so much. I think I learned my lesson." Service, actually infomercials, basically. You call in and you would get, at that point, live people, and I was one of those live people at the end of the line. And this hair care product line, you had the option of keeping whatever collection of products you wanted every month delivered on this regular basis, or you could call in and change it up a little, you know, different shampoo, different conditioner, whatever. Now, I have to tell you, incoming customer service is hell. It is 8 hours of verbal abuse. Only lonely old people and imbecilic assholes call on these phone lines. So what I'm about to tell you is a true story. This is exactly how one of the phone calls went. Ring, ring. "Hello, thank you for calling XYZ Hair Care Products. This is Megan Dupes. How may I help you today?"
Yeah. Like, I was wondering if I could change the conditioner that I'm going to get for next month.
Absolutely, I'd be more than happy to help you with that. But in order to better serve you, I do need your customer service number. That number is located above your name and address, and it starts with the number 10. Silence. 10 seconds goes by. 20 seconds goes by.
I'm starting to think we got disconnected until all of a sudden I hear, I can't find a number that starts with a 10, but I found the number that starts with a 10. Will that work? I tell you the truth, I still have the scars on my tongue from biting it so hard to tell, so that I didn't tell this woman exactly what I thought of her, because all I could do was politely say, yes, that number will work just fine. Thank you very much. And to this day, three things haunt me about this woman. One, does she drive? Two, does she vote? And the worst one is, has she procreated? So, I know that I've given you a whole bunch of information, and you guys have been awesome. I really want to thank you, but there's one last thing I want to leave you with tonight, and it's this. I want you to think outside of the box. Don't be afraid to use ink. And remember that life is way too short to care what other people think.